या मैम, नाउ इट इज अ सिलेक्शन। ओके मैम, ओके मैम, वी कैन, हाँ या मैम, आई थिंक वी कैन स्टार्ट। ऑलमोस्ट 54 हैव जॉइंड, सो वी कैन स्टार्ट मैम।
एक्चुअली आई मेड इट सिंपल टुडे। हेलो, आई मेड इट
Yeah, ma'am, you are audible.
I don't know you, how much it will be, how much you know and how much you need, but today I thought,
It's okay, ma'am, whatever it is.
Okay, fine. Because I didn't have much time also to next phase. Okay. During your exam, we'll have ECG discussion in clinical cases, ward rounds, spotters, and sometimes even during viva. So I thought first we'll just go to clinical cases, what the expected to answer. It may be simple, but I try to add some usual questions asked. Okay, this is from warm-up PCG. Anybody can take.
Before starting, ma'am, one second, ma'am. There are a lot of background noise. If you can, yes. Like, any door is open or like windows.
Is it okay? Hello?
Yeah, ma'am.
I'm not able to hear you properly, actually. That is a yesterday.
Okay, ma'am. You wear the earphones, ma'am. Then we'll see.
How is it without earphone?
No, now you are talking with earphone or without, ma'am?
Now I removed the earphone.
Now it is clear, coming clear for us, but I don't know about.
Okay, no problem then. Is it clear now?
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay, then no problem. I can hear you.
Okay, ma'am. We'll continue then.
Okay. Nikhil, anybody to interpret the CCG?
Arun, ma'am.
Change the color. Okay.
Arun, can you take?
Arun, I'll give you 1 minute time. Complete findings and possible diagnosis. I'm not able to hear anybody.
Arun, you there?
Okay. I have not unmuted. Okay.
Okay.
I was muted, ma'am. Okay.
Oh, you muted.
Ma'am, this is standard 12.
Are you able to see, Arun?
Ma'am? Able to see, ma'am.
Are you able to see?
Yes, ma'am.
So, this is the usual ECG you get after your multivalor case.
Yes, ma'am.
So, you can interpret.
It is standard 12. It is a standard 12-lead ECG with normal standardization, normal sinus rhythm, heart rate is 100 per minute, P wave is wider. The duration of the P wave is about 130 milliseconds. There is a P mitral present. P mitral present in V1 lead we can see. Then coming on to QRS complex, there is right axis deviation. The QRS axis
is anything else in the P wave and lead to
Ma'am, it is increased in height also. Both P pulmonale and P mitral are there.
Okay.
So you can see in V4 actually.
And
V4 to V6.
Then the right axis deviation, the QRS axis is AVR is perpendicular. So AVR is equiphasic. So the QRS axis is around 120 degree. Then
plus 120.
Ma'am.
Plus 120 degree.
Then prominent QRS complex is present in lead V1 with ST segment depression and which ST segment depression and T wave inversion suggestive of right ventricular hypertrophy and right ventricular systolic strain. So yes, ma'am, these are the findings. And QRS duration, QT interval is normal. So all these features
are suggestive of voltage. Is there any evidence of LVH?
LVH? No, ma'am.
No.
Well,
look at
V3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. V3 and V6, if we take, then it is satisfying voltage criteria for LVH.
Any other criteria you can apply for LVH?
Ma'am, S wave in V3 plus R wave in AVL.
What is the criteria?
That is Sokolov and voltage criteria.
R in AVL plus S in V3 more than?
More than 28 in male and 20 in female.
20 in females and 28
in male.
Yeah, this is a 25-year-old female. So, it's coronal voltage criteria, right?
Coronal voltage criteria, yes, ma'am.
It is there, LVH is there. See the tall R waves in V5, V6. Overlap in V4.
Yes, ma'am, overlapping.
Then there are some Q waves in V5. Is it volume overload or pressure overload? Once you say LVH, you are supposed to decide whether it is volume overload or pressure overload.
It looks like a volume overload, ma'am. Q waves are there. And no ST segment depression or T wave inversion. T waves are upright, so suggestive of volume overload.
Okay, now?
So there is a biatrial enlargement with biventricular enlargement with RV pressure overload and LV volume overload, suggestive of probably the patient has got mitral stenosis, aortic regurgitation, and pulmonary hypertension causing RVH.
Is it MR or AR?
MR or AR. There is a S wave in V2, so it is more likely to be MR than AR.
S wave in V2?
Sorry. More likely to be AR than MR. In MR, it will be lost.
So
MS, likely to be severe MS with...
Is there anything relation to the axis and the severity of MS?
Yes, ma'am. That is in isolated MS. If there is a QRS axis is more than 130 degree, it corresponds to the valvular orifice less than 1.3 centimeter square.
QRS axis how much?
QRS axis more than 130.
No. Plus 60. Huh?
Plus 60.
QRS axis more than plus 60 correlates with the orifice area of less than
1.3.
It's always asked because you will say axis is normal. Still, plus 60, more than plus 60 itself indicates significant mitral stenosis. Yeah. Sorry, for area of less than 1.3 axis, less than plus 60. Orifice area is
less than 1.3.
That is one correlation. There are other correlations with the axis. It can predict the pulmonary artery pressure. It can predict the pulmonary vascular resistance. Okay.
Yes.
Read those things. So this at least you should remember. Axis plus 60 itself. Here it is plus 120. So it indicates severe pulmonary hypertension. Okay, you read the other criteria.
Ma'am, one more thing. Okay. Lot of background noise. Hello. Can it be one of the DD? Can it be Luttenbacher, ma'am?
Luttenbacher, why? Luttenbacher, why you get LVH?
Okay. That is the point against. Yeah. Okay.
LV will be underprint.
Okay.
And left atrial enlargement is not a feature in Luttenbacher unless they develop atrial fibrillation. Because it decompresses into RA. It's predominantly like ASV. And you have incomplete RVV. It's a volume overload of right ventricle. Here it is pressure overload.
Pressure on. Okay, ma'am. So PH and left atrial appendage. Yeah, okay.
Yes. It presents mostly like ASD. The factor presents more like ASD.
Mm-hmm. ASD. Okay.
Left atrial enlargement is not a feature unless there is atrial fibrillation.
What, ma'am? Unless there is?
Atrial fibrillation.
Atrial fibrillation. Okay.
Am I clear, Nikhil?
Yeah, ma'am.
Here, for me, everybody's voice appears same.
Okay.
Is it clear? Anything else you
Yeah, ma'am. Your right atrial enlargement is due to PH, ma'am.
Right atrial enlargement is secondary to PH. And what happens when they develop PH?
When
the PA pressure goes beyond 50, 55, 60, what happens?
PND episodes will disappear. Will decrease, okay.
Yeah. TV annulus starts dilating and you get
Flexible regurgitation.
Okay.
Whatever doubts you want to ask, you ask here because this is the most common ECG chamber enlargement.
You should have totally MS with MR, madam. MS with MR.
MS with MR?
MS with MR with PAH.
Ma'am told no that V2 it is having S wave. S wave is in AR. Yeah.
It could be MS, MR, PHDR or it could be AR because the one differentiating point between AR and MR is you get good S waves in V1, V2 in presence of AR, whereas in MR because of the large left atrium, the S wave in V1, V2 may be small. So that is one differentiating point.
Here V1 is also not having S waves
now.
Huh? V1 is also not having deep S waves now.
Yes, V1 is not having deep S waves.
In spite of LVH.
Yeah, actually when there is biventricular hypertrophy, which we will be discussing later, LVH and RVH, they try to mask each other. So here, surprisingly, you have features for both RVH and LVH. Voltage criteria for both RPH and LPH. Okay, I just want to discuss briefly about some features of each chamber enlargement, which I know you know, but I want to highlight. Okay, you all know what are the criteria for right atrial enlargement, right? Can you just one of you can tell? Okay. No?
Yeah, ma'am. Morris and Macro's index, ma'am. Morris is P upon PR.
No, right, right.
we are starting with right atrial and left, then I'll go to left atrial. Just I want to highlight some things. What are the causes for right atrial enlargement?
120 millisecond, ma'am. The whole P wave.
No, right, right. We are talking about right, not left.
Yeah, ma'am. Right atrial enlargement. The negative terminal P. Forgot, ma'am.
Right atrial. P wave in lead to more than 2.5, ma'am. And P wave in lead V1 if it's more than 1.5. Ma'am.
The upward deflection of P wave. Yeah. P wave in V1.
And in V1, initial negative terminal deflection more than 0.03 milliseconds.
Oh, that voice is clear. The sneaking voice is not clear at all. What is happening?
Yeah.
We are discussing about right atrial enlargement, not left. I don't know whether you're talking about left. Am I clear or not?
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, ma'am. Hello.
Voice is clear?
Yeah, ma'am. Hello.
Why are you all telling about left atrial enlargement criteria? Harun, are you hearing Harun?
Yes, ma'am. Voice is clear, ma'am. Right atrial enlargement.
Okay.
Yeah, ma'am. I got.
Yeah, okay. You know that it is a tall peak P wave in lead 2 more than 2.5 millimeter, and P in V1 more than 1.5
millimeter. 1.5. Yeah, ma'am.
Okay. And, usually you call it as P pulmonary because that is the most common cause of right atrial enlargement. But what are the common causes in our practice? Right atrial enlargement?
In cardiology, it is pulmonary hypertension.
Tricuspid valve. TS, TR.
Tricuspid.
TS and PS. Okay, whenever the right ventricular hypertrophy is there, the right atrium has to work forcefully. So there will be right atrial enlargement or hypertrophy. So it's called right atrial abnormality also. So then when do you call it this? Classically P pulmonary. Usually this right atrial enlargement is called as P pulmonary. P pulmonary means it is secondary to lung pathology. Otherwise, why should you use pulmonary, right? It's used interchangeably, but some books specifically give P pulmonary as P wave axis more than plus 75 degrees. These criteria, right atrial enlargement with P axis more than plus 75 degrees. Okay. So you see an ECG of cor pulmonary, they will have rightward axis towards AVF will be taller than other leaves. Is it clear? Am I audible? Hello?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yes.
Background noise is. Yeah, ma'am.
No, simple question, ma'am. Simple question, ma'am. How to estimate the exact P wave axis, ma'am?
Is it okay? Am I clear?
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I want to ask one question. How to estimate P wave axis, ma'am?
P wave axis is calculated similar to the QRS axis. Suppose here we go back to the previous ECG. What will the P wave axis here? You have the minimal deflection of P here, right? VVL. Are you seeing?
Yes.
So the perpendicular to this lead 2. Lead 2, P is positive, so it is plus 60.
Okay, ma'am.
Around plus 60. So normally it is between plus 30 to plus 60 degrees. In right atrial enlargement, it goes towards right. If it crosses plus 75, most often it is because of lung pathology, cor pulmonary. Whereas in congenital heart disease or tricuspid valve diseases, the axis is normal, okay, less than, it's between 30 to 60 or so. Actually, some books even give P tricuspid, P congenital, you don't have to bother with that. So the axis will be normal, whereas only in lung pathology, the axis will be towards right.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
You heard of lead one sign of emphysema? No, in
tall,
everything. There will be right axis deviation of QRS, right axis deviation of P-waves. So, in lead one, P-wave will be small, QRS will be small. P-axis usually follows the QRS axis. So, everything will be almost small. So, because the axis of QRS as well as P will go towards the 90 degrees and so AVF everything becomes more prominent. P and QRS. So that is called lead one sign of emphysema. Okay?
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
So is everybody able to hear, Nikhil?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
your voice, ma'am. Clear.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
My network is little. Ma'am. My network is little bad, ma'am. That's why I'm not able to.
Whose network is bad?
Mine, ma'am. Mine.
Oh, you are.
Sorry.
Okay. So that is one point I want to tell in right atrial enlargement. This here you cannot afford to make any mistakes in chamber enlargement. So be thorough. Tall peak P waves in V2, 2.5 millimeter or more. And in V1, 1.5 millimeter or more. So that is the criteria for right atrial enlargement. And if somebody asks, many people use it interchangeably, right atrial enlargement as P pulmonary. But P pulmonary specifically means the axis should be more than plus 75 degrees and it is secondary to lung pathology. Then many times, you may be asked, what are the QRS criteria for right atrial enlargement? Can anybody answer?
Ma'am, QR pattern in V1 and increase in the amplitude by 3 times when we go to V2.
QR in V1.
Correct. So QR pattern in lead V1 in the absence of coronary artery disease. That is one. Second, QRS in lead V1 will be less than 5 millimeter, which becomes 3 times or more in lead V2. From V1 to V2. This is whole QRS amplitude. Okay. V1 it is small and it increases because of the large right atrium, the QRS amplitude decreases in V1. When you move to the V2, it increases at least 3 times from the V1. So these are the two QRS criteria which can be used even in presence of atrial fibrillation. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So what are the other causes? Here another question will arise. What are the other causes for QR in V1? One we said is coronary artery disease. All of you know that. What are the other two causes for Q in V1?
Suprasystemic PA pressure.
Suprasystemic PA pressure. And?
WPWS3
pathway. Correct transposition of? Great arteries. Did you tell that?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, corrected transposition of great vessels. You get Q in V1, but more important is absence of Q in V5 disease. That is more consistent than the Q wave in V1. Okay. So that is the second point I want to tell you here. Third is another question may be asked, what is the sensitivity and specificity of these criteria? See, most of the criteria for chamber enlargement has a low sensitivity, but they have high specificity. Here it may be, I don't know, 7 to 70% is too low for right atrial enlargement. It's given in Granlund, specificity of 0.5. Okay. You see this ECG? And tell me what are the findings and what are the what made the diagnosis? Are you able to see?
Himalayan P-waves.
Pragati is there?
Ma'am, Himalayan P-waves.
Huh?
Himalayan P-waves.
Himalayan P-waves. When they say Himalayan P-waves?
greater than 8 mm, ma'am.
No, you start. See, whenever you are given an ECG, you are supposed to start with standardization. I don't
know what it is here. 4 channel ECG with the lead 2 as rhythm shift, paper series 25 mm per second, I presume, ma'am. And standardization, I cannot see the standardization. It is around the 150.
Yes, yeah, in here. Okay.
Rate is around 150 per minute, sinus rhythm. But,
what are the features of sinus rhythm? When do you say it's sinus rhythm?
P waves with normal P wave morphology and axis, followed by QRS complex with the normal PR interval. And rate being.
So, what should be the P wave axis, or what should be the morphology of P in various limbs?
P wave should be upright in 1 and 2.
Lead 1, 2, and
AVF.
Lead 1, lead 2, and AVF, it should be upright.
Upright, and lead 2, it is taller than lead 1.
Maybe it should be negative in AVR.
Negative in AVR.
Yeah. Other lead 3 and AVL, it may be upright, biphasic, or negative. The most important lead 1, 2, and AVF, it should be positive. Sometimes they may ask the axis of P wave also what it should be. Okay, then what happens?
And axis around 30 to 40, ma'am.
Which axis you are talking about?
P wave axis only. Normal P wave axis.
Normal. Again, here also you can see AVL is almost biphasic, and you have B2 positive. So it is plus 60, normal axis. Okay. And you have a tall peak P wave. B2 is that you cannot miss. What is happening in B1 now?
It is biphasic.
It's biphasic. Or the negative P terminal is
from the 0.04.
Do you think it's left atrial enlargement? You read about other findings. What is the QRS axis?
QRS is it is right.
It's
like extreme axis, man. It is negative in lead 1 and it is right axis.
It's right axis, gross right axis. Okay. Approximately, can you tell what is the axis?
It is biphasic in lead AVF.
It's between plus 90 and plus 120. Yeah, whenever you ask axis, at least near to 15 degrees, you should be able to tell. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Between plus 90 and plus 120. Okay. Then.
QRS.
QRS
is 140. And RBB morphology.
We are getting RWAVE V1, V2, V3, V4. Then you have VPS phase, V5, V6. So what is it suggest you all?
Concordance pattern is good.
RVH with strain. What is the possible diagnosis here?
Pulmonary stenosis, madam. Pulmonary stenosis, ma'am.
Severe pulmonary stenosis. But the problem is only have tall peak P waves in V1, lead 2, but in V1 you have a negative P terminal force. So how do you explain this?
This can happen with right atrial enlargement.
Right atrial enlargement can itself cause this.
Possible with RA.
So if you read pulmonary stenosis in Perloff, the ECG as well as the description is given as P in lead V1 may be entirely negative. So that old Marriott used to say it is called pseudo P mitral. Okay. So then how do you differentiate it from left atrial enlargement? You have a P-terminal force, negative P-terminal force. How do you differentiate? So if it is due
narrow,
to right atrial enlargement, then deflection will be more vertical and intrinsicoid deflection, that is from the peak of the P wave to the nadir of the P wave, will be less than 30 milliseconds if it is right atrial enlargement. If it is left atrial enlargement, the slope is more. There it is vertical, here it is more. What? Are you seeing this ECG?
Yes, ma'am.
So we'll have an intrinsicoid deflection more than 30 milliseconds. Right atrial enlargement, it is less than 30 milliseconds from the beginning of the peak of the P wave to the nadir of the P wave. So here it is wider if it is due to left atrial enlargement. That is how you are supposed to differentiate. So don't get worried in a patient having a tall peak P waves in V2 and having a P-terminal force. This probably because the right atrium enlarges posteriorly, that's what is given in your Marriott. Recently I have not read about it, but this is the explanation given for negative P terminal force in V1. And we should be able to differentiate it from left atrium enlargement by the intrinsicoid deflection. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, just one more point. I think all of you know this classical tall peak P waves. Where all you get these kind of Himalayan, when do you see Himalayan P waves? It's already there, more than 5 millimeter P wave height. Now, anything more than 2.5 is right atrial enlargement. Anything more than 5 millimeter is Himalayan P waves. Where all you get this?
Epstein's.
Classically described in Epstein's.
Epstein's, ma'am, and tricuspid atresia.
You can get in tricuspid atresia, and you just now saw in pulmonary stenosis also, combined TSPS also. Okay.
Ma'am, giant wave also more than 5 mm, no, ma'am. Giant P waves. Giant P waves.
Same, giant A waves and Himalayan P waves are same. Giant P waves and Himalayan P waves are same. 5 millimeter or more. More than 5 millimeter. Anything else? Hello?
Ma'am, how to differentiate RV pressure hypertrophy and RV volume?
No, we are coming to that. I am going one by one chamber. Now it is right atrial enlargement. So any other doubts in right atrial enlargement? It's also called right atrial abnormality because it may be hypertrophy also. Okay, we'll move to the left atrial enlargement now, then I'll come to the right ventricle. Okay, you all know the criteria for left atrial enlargement. Wide B, wide bit P wave at the duration. See, up to 110 milliseconds, normally 100 to 110 milliseconds you can get normally. So it's 120 and above as a, and lead to as a high sensitivity. So all these sensitivity specificity may be asked, and these are from Granwald Wagner. Second, anything? Then second criteria is notching, the intrapeak distance more than 40 milliseconds, and this has the highest specificity. That is called camel hump, and it reaches 100% specificity, but high, low sensitivity. Then the third criteria is Macross index ratio. The P widens at the cost of the PR segment. PR interval remains same. P widens at the cost of the PR segment. So P by PR segment ratio is more than 1.6. Then you are all familiar with the Morris criteria, where the P terminal force has at least 1 millimeter in depth and 1 millimeter in width. And you take the product, it will be 0.04 millimeter second. 0.03 millimeter second is normal, but anything above that, that is 0.04 millimeter second, is abnormal. Granwald says it has high specificity, but
in the exam usually this is which is the highest specificity, that is interpeak distance more than 100 milliseconds, and Morris is supposed to have high sensitivity, highest sensitivity. Okay. So another commonly asked question is how to diagnose left atrial enlargement in patients with atrial fibrillation. Anybody?
The presence of atrial fibrillation itself suggests there will be left atrial enlargement.
Correct. So because left atrial enlargement more than 4 millimeter or 5 millimeter centimeter, sorry, 40 millimeter, above 40 millimeter, the incidence of atrial fibrillation is more. So in rheumatic heart disease, presence of atrial fibrillation itself indicates left atrial enlargement, but not in other conditions. Okay. So the atrial fibrillation is related to size of the left atrium and age of the patient. Most important factor is age. Second is size. Third may be severe. It's not a complication related to the severe. Other thing is coarse atrial fibrillation, where the fibrillary wave is more than 1 millimeter. Still, they ask that recent studies may not agree, but older studies show that occurrence of coarse fibrillatory wave and an abnormal P-terminal force, or a fine fibrillatory wave and a normal P-terminal force, was found to have highly significant relation. So coarse is 1 millimeter, more than 1 millimeter, fine is less than 1 millimeter. What is fine line fibrillation? Line fibrillation. Anybody? Coarse, fine,
ma'am, what, ma'am?
Line fibrillation. Am I audible? Arun? Nikhil?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Okay. When PVs are totally
absent. Don't mean there are no fibrillary waves. You get irregular RR waves, no P waves, and no fibrillary waves also. So these fine and lines are more common in ischemic heart disease and hypertensive heart diseases. Whereas coarse fibrillation is more common in rheumatic heart disease because it's somewhat related to the size of the left atrium. So whenever there is abnormal P-terminal force, so that is evidence of left atrial enlargement, you get coarse fibrillation. That's what is this study in 1966. Okay.
Hello, ma'am. Ma'am, you're using your headphones, ma'am.
Because no, I'm not using my headphone.
Ma'am, can you use, ma'am, because we are getting a lot of background noise. I don't know why it is coming. So we are getting vehicle noise. That's why.
Maybe from others, I think.
So oh, all are muted. Only man is there. I don't know what is the issue. Ma'am, you are muted, ma'am. Hello. Hello. Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Yeah, ma'am. You were muted, I think.
I'm muted. Yeah. Will I know I'm muted or not?
No, now you are unmuted. Now we can continue.
Okay. Am I audible now?
Yeah, ma'am. You are audible. Only thing is that background noise was coming too much. I don't know because all were muted. We'll see, ma'am. Okay.
I'm in a very quiet room, Nikhil.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, we'll continue, ma'am. We'll see.
I even switched off the phone fan also because it was very small.
Okay, ma'am. We'll continue, ma'am. We'll see. Yeah.
Arun, everybody's hearing?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. You're clear, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Your voice is clear. Sir, is something wrong with Nikhil's, I think.
Yeah, ma'am, maybe.
Okay. Now, that is about left atrial enlargement I want to share with you.
ma'am, one doubt, ma'am. Ma'am, this third line is there now, ma'am. Both are significant, ma'am. Presence of fine fibrillatory wave also significant.
Fine fibrillation, less than 1 millimeter. It's usually seen in hypertensive heart disease or ischemic heart disease. Usually in rheumatic heart disease, you get coarse atrial fibrillation. I don't know what whether I answered your question. Your voice is not clear.
No, ma'am. Ma'am, in the third, they have given both of have highly significant relationship. So, what is the exact meaning of it? Whether it is in left atrial enlargement or it is specific to rheumatic heart disease?
No. In rheumatic rheumatic heart disease, it's AF is related to the size of the left atrium. So it will have coarse fibrillation. Whereas in other causes, it's not related to the size of the left atrium. I don't know whether Emma, if your question is not clear, Nikhil.
Madam, here we have to calculate P terminal force, madam.
Yeah.
Even in fine atrial fibrillation also, we have to calculate the terminal force.
What? No. This study. This. How can you calculate preterminal force in atrial fibrillation? That's what you're asking.
It was showing fine fibrillatory wave and a normal preterminal force that will suggest left atrium.
No, this was the study. See, what they did, all patients in atrial fibrillation, they give a DC shock or they converted it to sinus rhythm. Then they correlated with the P-terminal force. So whenever patients had a fine fibrillation, the P-terminal force was normal. Whenever they had coarse fibrillation, the P-terminal force was abnormal. So these patients initially were in atrial fibrillation, then they are converted to sinus rhythm. That is what the study done. So that is why they are saying there is some relation between fibrillary waves and the left atrial size. Is it clear?
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
It's not clear, I can.
So when there is atrial fibrillation, you can't come out of the chamber in the ICM, ma'am.
In rheumatic heart disease, atrial fibrillation is related to the one of the factors is LA size. One is most important is age, of course. Second is left atrial size. So whenever there was this study was basically in patients with atrial fibrillation, and when they converted to sinus rhythm, they just measure the P-terminal force. Okay. So otherwise, you don't start telling about when atrial fibrillation is there, don't start talking about the criteria, Morris criteria and all those things, which you cannot apply. Only thing, presence of AF, its first answer will be presence of AF itself indicates left atrial enlargement in rheumatic heart disease, not in other diseases, okay? If it is some elderly hypertensive IHD, you cannot apply that. It's only in rheumatic heart disease. Second, coarse atrial fibrillation, where the fibrillary wave is 1 millimeter or more, may be correlated with the large left atrium. So these are two things expected. Shall we move on to the next? Hello?
Yeah, ma'am, yeah, ma'am.
So, biatrial enlargement, you will have features of both LA, RA. It's not like biventricular hypertrophy. It is not that difficult here. You will have large biphasic P in lead V1, tall because of right atrial enlargement, negative because of left atrial enlargement. And you will have tall, broad P waves as we saw in our patient, tall, broad P waves in inferior leads. So you, sometimes you may have both, especially in patients with mitral valve disease and tricuspid valve disease secondary to pulmonary hypertension, you may have both atrial enlargement. Okay, you know all the criteria for right ventricular hypertrophy. Most important being all are in V1.
RS ratio more than one, all those things, you know. Most important is right axis deviation. You may not have any R wave criteria in recorded leads, but if there is a right axis deviation, that goes in favor of right ventricular hypertrophy. Suppose patient has aortic stenosis, aortic regurgitation, you have LVH, and just right axis deviation in limb leads, that is enough to diagnose right ventricular hypertrophy. You may not have other criteria. So that is one thing. So other criteria, I think you're all familiar with that, not working. Okay. So again, sensitivity is low, but in pulmonary hypertension, congenital heart disease, pulmonary hypertension, it may be as high as 74%. Is again, this is given in Granwald. Accurate, it's more accurate, that is specificity. It's greatest in patients with congenital heart disease, this criteria, and lowest in COPD. Because right ventricle hypertrophy has to manifest. To manifest, it needs more severe enough to overcome the masking effects of larger LV forces. So that's where maybe in COPD you don't get very prominent right ventricular hypertrophy findings on the ECG.
Ma'am, this sensitivity is for R wave in V1 more than 7 mm. For that.
Pardon?
This
your R in V1 7 mm or more. And QR in V1, RS ratio more than 1. So these are the usual. The same thing, V5, V6, you have opposite of that. RS ratio less than 1. S wave in V5, V6 more than 0.7. And of course, S1, Q3, T3, S2, S1, S2, S3, all those things have low sensitivity. So, some more about right ventricular hypertrophy.
Ma'am, if there is a QR in V1, how to know whether it is secondary to RVH or right atrial enlargement, ma'am?
That question arises when only there is atrial fibrillation. Otherwise, you get a tall peak PVS in lead 2.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. There will be other criteria for right atrial enlargement. The difficulty may be only when there is atrial fibrillation. It is not that common in right-sided diseases.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So, pressure overload, you have a monophasic. Anyway, right axis deviation is common. It's a must actually in right ventricular hypertrophy. You get a monophasic QRS in V1, V2. It may go on to V3, and the transition zone is move towards left. May not even you may not get prominent RVS at all. So as you go towards V5, V6, you get deep S waves. So and in volume overload there will be ST depression and T inversion V1 to V3. This is RVS with pressure overload. Monophasic QRS with ST depression, T inversion V1 to V3. How is it different in TAF? TAF also you have RVH, no? This is usually asked question. The difference between RVH in TAF versus RVH in PS with intact interventricular.
Early transition, madam.
Yeah, the sudden transition from V1 to V2, early transition. That is one. Other thing is, you will not get this
monophasic RV won't get.
Monophasic you will get in V1, V2 you get a deep S waves. Okay, one point. Second, usually you will not get strain pattern because RV pressure cannot become suprasystemic, right? So you will not get classical strain pattern. The strain pattern is a feature of isolated PS, severe PS with intact IVS, okay, where RV pressure can become suprasystemic. Or it may be PH, pulmonary hypertension. Classically, you see this monophasic QRS with strain pattern in V1, V2, V3 in severe PH or severe PS, pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary hypertension. Is it clear? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. But another question usually asked is, in pure valvular PS, how do you calculate RA systolic pressure? That can be done only when in the age group of 2 to 20 years. You take the height of R wave and multiply it by 5. It gives the RV systolic pressure. So here suppose it is 5, 10, 15. 15 into 5. So RV pressure is likely to be 75. Age is between 2 to 20 years. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
I think you all know this. Okay, next is pressure overload. Sorry, volume overload. So pressure overload versus volume overload. Even on the right side, you can differentiate. So classically, it is RS R dash pattern in V1. Where do you see this? What are the causes of volume overload of the right ventricle?
ASD.
TRPR.
ASD, TRPR. Like MRAR, you have TRPR. And like VSTPD, you have ASD. So ASD. Okay. So another question is, I think we discussed in the previous class, how do you diagnose RVH in presence of RBBB? If it is incomplete RBBB, the second R, or the R prime, should be more than 10 millimeter. If it is complete RBBB, this height of the R prime should be, or R dash should be more than 15 millimeter. So this was described by Barker and Valencia. So incomplete RBBB more than 10 millimeter, complete RBBB more than 15 millimeter. Without RBBB it is how much?
7.
7 millimeter. So 7, 10 and 15. Is it clear? We'll go to the next.
Yes.
The right axis deviation is also suggestive of RVH in the presence of RBBB.
Right axis deviation?
In the presence of RBBB, will suggest RVH.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Another commonly question asked with commonly asked question is types of right ventricular hypertrophy. So we already discussed about type 1, that is typical pressure overload RVH. Type 2 is incomplete RBBB, that is volume overload RVH. Type 3 is non-progression of R waves seen in COPD. RS complex is formed, small r decays in V1, V2 and almost equal R and S in V5, V6. So that's because RVH plus displacement of the heart. Is it clear?
Yes. Why we won't get prominent R wave in type? That is COPD patients. Any explanation for that, ma'am? In V1? In COPD, this type 3 is, you know, any explanation for that, ma'am? Why won't get prominent R wave in V1? In COPD?
They say it is because the heart is displaced.
Okay.
Then whenever there is a tall R increase. Hello, who is this? I cannot hear only. It's not
clear. Excuse me, ma'am. Hello. Hello, ma'am. Can you hear me, ma'am?
Is it Nikhil?
No, ma'am. It's Neeraj, ma'am. I don't understand.
Arun, your voice was better before. Now I don't know what happened. What is the question?
Hello, ma'am. Ma'am, yeah, the question, ma'am, is there any way to grade RVH, ma'am? Are there any criteria to grade RVH in terms of the PVH?
RVH, how to grade RVH?
Yeah, on ECG, yes, ma'am.
I'm not aware, except that multiplying by 5 in pure PS. I'm not aware of assessment of severity of RVH. Maybe we'll find out.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
So, LVH, okay, before that, what are the other causes for tall R in V1? Suppose you get an ECG, there is a tall R wave, you are not able to explain. What are the other causes? Quickly, 4,
three more common causes and then less common causes.
Posterior wall MI.
Posterior wall.
Okay.
WPW.
Okay.
Muscular dystrophy. Muscular dystrophies.
Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Hypertrophy. Then lead is misplacement. Or heart displacement, and sometimes it can be normal variant also.
Madam, ARVD, madam.
RBBB, na? Whenever there is RV, dilatation, you get RS or dash. Then you will be describing every cause for RV, volume overload or pressure overload. It's just, I don't know whether you have anything else in your mind. RV is dilated, no? There? Arun, na? Who asked this question?
No, ma'am, not me.
Okay. Anyway, these are the classical answers. You know most of them. Why? Okay. Then we'll move on to the left ventricular hypertrophy. So at least three criteria you should know. Sucralion, coronal voltage, and what is the other one you should know?
Roman
modified Roman and modified
Rommel
voltage
duration criteria.
Yes. So these three things you should be thorough, because any case you have one of the case may have LVH. So you will be asked the criteria for LVH. You should not fumble here. So I think R in AVL more than 11 millimeter, that is usually expected question. Other one is coronal voltage. They are quite. Sometimes they help when there is no clear-cut voltage, that is S in V1 plus R in V5. That is not there, then you look at these things, okay? This, you'll have to buy heart. Okay, some, again, the sensitivity will be, usually they'll ask this also. Each one, they may ask sensitivity, Buclolion, all of these have low sensitivity up to 15-20%, but they have high specificity. 90-99%. Then, this is not very clear. Here you know all systolic overload pattern, diastolic overload pattern, right? Systolic overload, you will have a deep Q waves, which is narrow. Sorry, systolic overload, you will have absence of Q waves and ST depression and left precordial leads and T inversion. Diastolic overload, you will have deep Q waves, which is narrow. Sometimes it may be as much as 5 to 10 millimeters. And you have concave upward ST elevation. There, ST depression is convexity upwards. Here it is concave upward ST elevation in left precordial leads with the upright or tall T waves, sometimes mistaken for MI. If the patient comes with the chest pain, you see this ST elevation, tall T waves, even they are thrombolized in your hospital. The next day somebody auscultates, there is a medium ER number. Okay. So you're all familiar with this LVH strain pattern, that is pressure overload. Absence of Q waves, ST depression with convexity upwards and asymmetric T inversion and prolonged. When VAT, what is VAT?
Ventricular
activation time.
Okay. Intrinsic ventricular.
Ventricular activation time.
Okay. So that is one of the criteria used in rheumatic test. So QRS becomes wider and the Q disappears. It will be looking like a incomplete RBBB. Then later they may develop complete RBBB. Classical, you see in DCM. So initially they may have LVH, then it may become LVBB later. So here the Q waves, absence of Q waves is supposed to be possibly due to pressure of the septum, it's the IVS and part of incomplete LVB. Okay, volume overload, you're all familiar. Again, deep Q waves, ST elevation with concavity upwards and tall upright.
So another commonly asked question, how do you differentiate T inversion of LVH versus ischemic heart disease? In strain pattern, the T is asymmetric. If you put a line here, it is asymmetric. It's blunt. It's not usually deep, but sometimes you may get classical ischemic T inversion is symmetrical T inversion. It's pointed. How do you diagnose LVH in presence of LVBB? So LVBB will mask or LVBB will. It's difficult, no?
WLON criteria more than 45
mm. Okay, anyway, this I'm not very sure. I'll have to find out. I just call this. Anyway, you can use this R in AVL criteria more than 11 millimeter and left atrial enlargement and QRS voltage will be more, so you'll have to use more than, how much did you say here? It's 40, maybe more than that. Anyway,
45.
Okay, 45. Okay, then similarly you should know LVH criteria for LVH in RBBB.
In the presence of RBBB, no change,
no change. It actually, the sensitivity comes down. Limb bleed is less affected. It will not change. In Brownsis, it changes. Sensitivity is lower. The presence of left atrial enlargement, left axis deviation helps, but sensitivity comes down. Okay, fine. Other questions asked in LVH. What is the single limb criteria for LVH?
AVL more than 11 mm.
You know that, but in that you should be prepared, because unless you have the thought of it, you will not. The answer will not come out. Other question is R in V5 and V6. What is the normal? What is normal? What happens in LVH?
In V5, it should be taller than V6.
If V6, yeah, normally. Okay. So if V6 is equal to R in V5 or more than in V5, that is suggestive of LVH. Then STT changes, how to differentiate from digoxin effect and toxicity from volume. Yep.
Inversing sign.
How do you diagnose biventricular hypertrophy? Again, specific criteria for both LVH and RVH may be there, but it is rare. So whenever there is left ventricular hypertrophy, look for axis. In LVH, axis may go towards left. As it goes towards left, it may develop even left anterior fascicular block, because the left and the fibrosis in this left anterior fascicle, they may develop left anterior hemiplock. But if you find right axis deviation, that is suggestive of biventricular hypertrophy. And you all know the classical Cartes-Walk shunt phenomena. I'll show an ECG. Then if you get tall R in right as well as left recorded leads. In RVH, as you go towards the left recorded leads, you get deep S waves. So if you have both tall R in right as well as left recorded leads, that is suggestive of biventricular hypertrophy. And LVH with persistent S waves in V5, V6. That is also suggestive of additional right ventricular hypertrophy. And usually one more criteria given in old Marriott called shallow S wave. You get a small S in V1, which becomes at least 3 times in V2. Because of RVH, you don't get prominent S in V1. If in V2, the S becomes 3 times the S of V1, that is suggestive of biventricular hypertrophy. It is not QRS amplitude. In right atrial enlargement, it is QRS amplitude which changes from V1 to V2. Is it clear?
Can you repeat that one, ma'am?
The shallow S wave. In V1, when there is right ventricular hypertrophy, you get a tall R in V1. Okay, there will be a small S wave. If this S wave becomes at least 3 times in V2, that is called shallow S wave.
used as shallow SEO syndrome as well. So in V1, because of REH, you don't get the S wave of LV. When you move towards the V2, it starts picking up the LV forces. So you get a deep S wave in V2. So from V1 to V2, it will be 3 times or more. In right atrial enlargement, it is whole QRS amplitude. Here it is just the S wave. Okay.
Ma'am, this S wave criteria is along with tall R wave in V1.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay. So you'll have tall R in V1, just the S wave becoming 3 times from V1 to V2. Okay. So this everyone knows, Schwarzschild phenomena, classically seen in large VST or PDA with the most large left right shunt. They should have large left right shunt. Just large VST PDA with severe PH will not have this. The small shunts, normal ECG, when you have moderate to large shunt, you get LV, volume overload vessel as RV, pressure overload. So here you have a tall R in V1 also. So you can see the tall R and deep S waves, mid precordial leads, V2, V3, V4. If you add this R plus S, it should be more than 45 millimeter in adults and 60 millimeter in children. So that is called Schwarzschild phenomena. You commonly ask whenever you get a congenital heart disease, VST or PD. So you should look for this large equiphasic QRS complex in mid precordial leads, V2 to V4.
I'm in doubt, ma'am. That digoxin effect and LVH, how to differentiate LV strain pattern?
I thought you'll read and tell me in the next class.
Okay, ma'am. Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, I'll show you next class. Next, I think we're coming to the last. This is a 25-year-old female with a systolic murmur. Can you read this easily? Any takers? Hello? Start reading, no? Arun, Nikhil, who else is there?
Yes, ma'am.
Nikhil
has standard value.
Yeah, ma'am.
Nikhil, your voice, let me hear your voice. Is it clear now?
Yeah, ma'am. I'm able to hear, ma'am. Yeah, ma'am.
Okay. No background noise, Nikhil?
Yeah, ma'am.
Hello.
Okay.
Ma'am, it's a 12-lead 6-channel ECG, ma'am.
Anybody, I just know the 3 people, that's why I'm saying. Anybody can answer that.
12-lead 6-channel ECG, madam.
With
standardization height of 10 millimeters and speed is appears to be half, madam.
What is that? Speed, okay, go ahead.
Speed appears to be half.
Speed normal, okay, fine. Okay, fine.
The speed is half
normal.
It's 25 millimeter per second. It's written in the left bottom.
Speed is normal.
It's written here. Yeah, it's written here. Okay. Can you see the pointer there?
Ah, man. But the diagram was showing narrow. That is not one full box.
Which one?
And standardization diagram will be there.
It's okay. It's written 25. Go ahead with the reading.
Okay. With P-wave axis appears to be normal and appears to be sinus rhythm.
So first tell sinus rhythm. First rhythm, rate.
Sinus rhythm.
Rate, then rhythm. Yes.
Heart rate of 75, man. Sinus rhythm with axis plus 90 degrees, man.
Okay.
with QRS RBBB pattern is there, madam.
RSR dash in V1.
RSR dash in V1.
You have persistent SOS in V5, V6.
Persistent SOS in V5, V6.
Yes. So what is the possibility? What is the possibility?
AX V1.
Accepted effect.
Okay. Anything else you missed in this ECG?
Crocodile sinus.
Crocodile.
You can see the classical notching of QRS in 2-3 area.
Suggest of atrial septal defect.
It's supposed to be highly sensitive and specific for large ostium secundum,
yes.
Sinus venosus ASDs. What other ECG findings you look for in ASD?
Right ventricular hypertrophy is also there in this ECG, ma'am.
Hmm.
Incomplete RBBB with...
Fine, yeah, it's more than 10 millimeter. Then?
PR prolongation.
Where do you get PR? Which patients you get PR prolongation?
Familial ASDs.
Familial AST.
And?
Primum
ASTs. Primum ASTs, yeah, you can get AV prolonged PR interval in familial, like cold toram AST, cold toram patients, and ostium primum AST. Then, what happens to the P axis? Somebody mentioned about P axis. What is the significance of P axis in AST? I know this was discussed in one of the classes.
Sinus venosus.
Yeah, because the sinus node is abnormal. So you get subsidiary pacemakers from the atria. So you get left axis deviation of the P waves. Then QRS axis. You should also look for left axis deviation of
ostium primum AST.
Yeah, why do you get that? The left anterior fascicle is thin and hyperplastic. It's long, thin and hyperplastic. That is why there is delayed conduction in the left anterior fascicle. So you get left axis deviation in ostium primum AST and any AV canal defect because of abnormal left anterior fascicle, long, thin and hyperplastic. Okay, any other findings in ASD? I used to ask our students 10 findings of
early transition.
Slurring of S waves in SVC type, ma'am, in inferior leads.
Okay. What happens to sinus in a child? No, you get an ECG in normally ECG lab. Marked sinus.
Sinus arrhythmia.
Yeah. Absence of sinus arrhythmia. Most often, you don't find sinus arrhythmia in AST. Suppose if this lady comes at 40 years, what else you expect?
Atrial arrhythmias,
all sorts of atrial ectopics, atrial tachycardia, atrial fibrillation, atrial arrhythmias. Okay, all this you should expect. So this was described by Heller, this Crocetage sign. It's supposed to be sensitive and specific for large shunts. Not in ostium primum, because in ostium primum you get left axis deviation, you don't get this. Okay, should we stop here or go on? Hello?
According to you, ma'am.
Actually,
okay, ma'am, we will do next class, ma'am. No problem. Okay.
No, I am ready, but I thought it will be too much in one day. Mm-hmm.
Okay, ma'am, we'll stay take step by step. So today we have discussed all chamber enlargement.
Yeah.
So yeah, ma'am.
So. Any doubts?
Yes, ma'am. I had a question.
Yeah.
Ma'am, is there some definitive relationship between a given bundle branch block and axis? Like they say in VT, RBVB with left axis is suggestive of VT. Earlier we said RBVB with right axis deviation is suggestive of RVH. Is there some sort of a normal relationship between a bundle branch block and axis, ma'am?
Yeah. LBBB usually will have normal axis.
Usually they tell in Shamrock they are given like bundle branch block per se will not cause any axis deviation.
Yes.
Only if it is associated with some particular block, it can cause axis deviation.
Correct. Yeah, LBBB, left normal axis. Correct.
Okay. Sorry.
LBBB, when they have left axis deviation, you think of damage, more damage to the
system.
But when there is LBBB right axis deviation, it is more specific for a
dilated cardiomyopathy.
See, in dilated cardiomyopathy, most of the ECG findings are non-specific. There are only two fairly specific ECG findings. One is LBBB with right axis deviation. Other is low voltage in limb bleeds, normal or increased voltage in precordial loops. So those are supposed to be two very specific findings for BCM. So like that, LBBB normally will have a normal, usually will have a normal axis. Can you get...
also with RBVB, ma'am.
Yeah. Which is more ominous? RBVB or LBVB?
Left LBVB. Because left bundle branch is a thick bundle.
So what are the four common causes for LBVB?
Hypertension, disease, then
ischemic heart disease.
Hypertension.
DCM. Cardiomyopathy is then aortic stenosis. Even in ARC, late stages you can get. So, can you have LBBB without structural heart disease? With a normal heart?
Less than
1%.
No, it's 10%.
RBVB,
RBVB is more common, but LBBB also without underlying heart disease. 10%.
Okay.
10% can have LBBB without underlying heart disease.
RBBB, ma'am, is it higher than LBBB?
RBBB is higher.
Okay.
See, RBBB can be an early manifestation of your degenerative conduction system, no? So you do not have any other problems like. But LBBB, they say presence of LBBB, the mortality and morbidity will be higher. Later they may develop problems.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. Hello, ma'am. One more doubt. This 10 features you told, ma'am. ASD. I'll just tell you.
Don't ever tell like you. Don't start with like that. Whenever you ask some question, don't tell me.
Okay.
It's not leaving to tell all 10. I'm just joking.
Yeah, ma'am. Any other feature is left? That's what I wanted to ask. Absence of sinus arrhythmia, AF, long PR, right axis, left axis, protege sign, incomplete RBV. Anything is left, ma'am?
Left axis deviation of P wave and QRS, and right axis also in other results. Incomplete arrhythmias. Then you have PR prolongation, atrial arrhythmias, absence of sinus. Anything else? Next. Okay. Right atrial enlargement.
Okay. 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 Anything else?
Anything
doubts?
Any other doubts?
Ma'am, what you told about that left anterior fascicle in ostium primum?
Left anterior fascicle is long, thin because of the defect in the in that area. It's long, thin and hyperplastic.
So that leads to left axis deviation in ostium primum.
Yes, there is delayed conduction in the left anterior fascicle. You read ostium primum is the Perloff. I think I sent one photo to Nikhil. Nikhil, you remember?
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah.
And I'll share.
It's in Perloff. So it is because it is hyperplastic, there is delayed conduction, so you get left axis deviation.
Thank you.
Anything else?
Thank you. No, ma'am. One more thing, ma'am. Anyone else doubts are remaining? Okay. Nothing, ma'am. We have just collected some amount for donation, like that. So we are taking all the suggestions from the teacher regarding where to donate. And ma'am, later I'll call you, ma'am, regarding what where to donate or like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, these are the patients, your clinical case oriented. Then I thought Potter and Ward Rounds will do some other day. Is that okay?
Okay, ma'am. Yeah, ma'am. Yeah.
Or you are bored of this?
No, ma'am. We need this. A lot of small points we sometimes miss.
Yeah. I want to see if the first impression is created during clinical examination. So there is thorough. First case, especially a val case, everything about ECG will be discussed. So you have to spend some 10 minutes on ECG. Everything can be asked.
Yeah, ma'am.
You should be thorough with everything, like chamber enlargement, axis.
Okay,
ma'am. TT changes. Okay. So next we'll have these other things. Quad round here.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.